GI and nutrition issues. I am absolutely convinced that you, that this will be the highlight of your conference. If not for all of the PPAG conferences that you have attended or for other conferences that have been part of your careers. We have been working on the concept of hearing from pediatric patients and leaders and youth for a little while now. And honestly, when we first started, we thought through the last time that we heard from a patient or a youth and counted that at a big fat zero. Just to put that in perspective, that's like trying to come up with solutions for women's health without any women being on the call. It's like trying to solve immigration issues without talking to anyone that's actually immigrated. And so not having heard from pediatric patients is something that we're changing. And we'd like to thank very much Aegis Darcy, who is one of the leaders for this group and has started the drug development committee over this last year that helped us identify this particular group as being the one that we wanted to hear from and being an example for group the ICAN groups that we want to partner with in all of our cities. And so ICAN stands for the International Children's Advisory Network. And they partner with many organizations in helping to consult and hear from the voices of children and youth that are directly involved in the sciences and in the research topics that we currently do and in many other aspects of our care. And so I couldn't possibly be more excited and more thankful for Idris in helping to do this. And very apropos is to have Madison be the first speaker and help lead this talk, who is Idris's daughter. And so you could say that Madison is both genetically and environmentally linked to this organization. we're very happy for that. And so without further ado, Madison.
What would it be like if kids could have a say in the design of a pediatric clinical trial, or devices that are being developed for them, or apps that are used for their healthcare? What would it be like if kids gave input into the development of informed study consent so that they really understand what they are reading and signing? What would it be like if kids could help you understand how they learn best about their medicines and treatment? This is what we're here to talk to you about today. ICAN, the International Children's Advisory Group, is the group that we represent, and our main goal is to provide kids the opportunity to have a voice in medical innovation. Over the next hour, I'm going to give you an overview of how ICAN operates, and then Chase Kelly will come up and share with you the details of how we started Kids Georgia, which is our local group, and share some of the activities that our group has been involved with. And then Kaylee, Matthew, and Hampton will come up and share their medical journeys with you. So ICAN is a worldwide network, and we have 17 chapters around 6 countries, and each group consists of kids ages 8 through 18 who are interested in learning about science, health, and medicine, and also desire to give feedback to research, doctors, and innovators. Our mission is to improve pediatric healthcare by providing a platform for children and their families to provide input and feedback on study designs and treatment plans that are designed for the care of children. So, locally, the U.S. groups are known as KIDS, and our main goal is to teach children about research, science, and health advocacy. We also facilitate meetings between children and healthcare professionals. Internationally, all the groups around the world in ICAN attend regional and national conferences such as the American Academy of Pediatrics and the PAS meetings, where we survey participants, speak in panels, and the children can speak in the panels and present abstracts, and we have a booth there where we provide information about our group. We also have virtual meetings with researchers, online surveys, and an annual research and advocacy summit that each ICAN group goes to. How it all started, the ICAN group formed from the Young Persons Advisory Group, which was a group in Europe that started in 2009, and other groups around the world noticed how successful they were, so they decided to form organizations of their own. So next, a group was formed in Vancouver called Kids Can, and the idea of ICAN came after a successful pilot program in Connecticut formed called Kids Connecticut in 2013. And then after this, other kids groups were formed in the US, and then ICAN was formed as an umbrella organization for all of these organizations worldwide to collaborate underneath. So internationally, we have, this is a list of all of our groups in Europe, in Asia Pacific, and in North America, we have Kids Can in Vancouver, Kids Central Ohio, Kids Connecticut, Georgia, Houston, Illinois, Kansas City, and Michigan, and then the rest underneath that with the asterisks are groups that are in development. Here are some examples of what ICAN has done concerning collaborative projects. We, through groups such as industry-sponsored studies and the Global Alliance for Pediatric Therapeutics Ascent Project, our ICAN groups are able to provide whole global feedback through these groups. ICAN, internationally, we have attended meetings and conferences such as the AAP and PAS. We've done multimedia presentations and platforms and posters. For example, we've done this at the European Medicines Agency, UNICEF, and AAP, as well as participated in publications. So these are some pictures of meetings that we've attended. This is at the PAS in San Diego, and you can see our booth up there. And this is also the American Academy of Pediatrics meeting, where we had a booth, and you can see that in the bigger picture, they were taking surveys, and it was a very popular event, a very popular booth that everyone was interested in. So this summer, we are having our second research summit at Barcelona. So this is where all the ICAN groups come together and discuss what they've experienced throughout the year and what projects they've done and what research they've given feedback on. So if you're interested in getting involved, you can engage in a local team in your area or start a new team if there isn't one yet formed. You can visit our website at icanresearch.org or also visit our booth at different conferences that we have. And for more information, you can email Idris Darcy, who is a PPAG member, at idris.darcy@pfizer.com, and these slides will be available later. So now I'm going to welcome Chase up to talk about how Kids Georgia was formed and what kind of activities we do there. Thank you.
Okay, so I would like to begin by introducing myself. These past 2 years, I was the president of Kids Georgia. I'm currently in 12th grade, and I'm about to move on to Georgia Tech, where I am planning on majoring in biology and hopefully taking a pre-med course. So I would like to start by giving you all an example of how to start a kids program. So you first have to identify leaders in the group, and you need leaders that have connections all around. So let me give you the leaders that we have and kind of explain how they have helped. So we have a clinical research manager, we have a global medical director, and we also have a pediatrician. So the goal of this is to partner with hospitals, have someone involved in the corporate aspect of it, and also have someone who works with patients in order to bind all of this together to get the maximum participation. So some of the key connections that we've had to make these programs successful include Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, Emory, Georgia Tech, Atlanta Clinical and Translational Science Institute, Morehouse School of Medicine, Dunwoody Pediatrics, the Georgia Chapter of American Academy of Pediatrics, also the American Academy of Pediatrics, and even local schools. So the way this works is there are multiple different levels of membership, and also even in different organizations there are different requirements. So for example, in Ohio, they have college students. In Kansas City, they have only clinical trial patients. And in Georgia, we do have a mix of high school students, people interested in medicine, ages 8 to 18, and especially clinical trial patients as well. So the way our memberships work is either you've had past experience with a clinical trial, you have some experience using hospital services, some knowledge of taking medicine, interest in medicine or research, or you could even be the parent or guardian of such children. So how did we get started? Early in 2014, we had interested leaders, and what they did is generated interest from those local groups that I mentioned earlier. And then in December of 2014, we had our first Kids Georgia meeting at Georgia Tech, where we got to see their capstone design exposition, and we got to explore some of the project that the engineering students created in order to graduate. Then in February of 2015, there was an adult advisory meeting hosted by Children's Healthcare Atlanta, and not only were there representatives from the slides listed previously, but we also had our group attend in order to really spread the word about Kids Georgia. So Kids Georgia meets approximately once a month during the school year, and our team is structured with an executive board of students who have a very large role in running meetings and the organization behind those meetings. We had our first officer start in the fall of 2014, and they developed the bylaws, the structure, and the website. And very soon we were transitioning into our second board as this outgoing board either moves up or graduates. So, like I said, we have had many meetings, including meetings at Children's Healthcare Atlanta, Georgia Tech, University of Georgia, Morehouse School of Medicine, Marcus Autism Center, and the Global Center for Medical Innovation. So I will show you some pictures and kind of explain what we did at some of these meetings. So here's the Invention Studio at Georgia Tech. And we got to tour this Invention Studio because they have a lot of 3D printers. And we got to get an insight on the future of 3D printing technology, whether that be printing tissues or even organs. We also went to Morehouse School of Medicine, and here we got to speak with a panel of residents and students and people who have graduated and have their doctorate, and got to ask them questions about medical school and the path that they took. Here we were at Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, where Georgia Tech students also came in to show us their projects, and we got to give them feedback on these little experimental and these instructional projects that they had. We also toured part of Children's Healthcare and got to see some behind the scenes labs and rooms like that. Here's another example of us doing Georgia Tech projects and giving them feedback. We kind of made a little blood fluid to give the analogy to these kids of what makes up the blood, and that's just one of the many examples that they have kind of taught us about. Here we were at UGA, and we got to experience more of the virtual side of things here. We got to see a lot of virtual reality equipment, and also even using iPads to take a picture of a heart and make it 3D and analyze the heart. Here's another example of Georgia Tech where we made wheelchairs, and that was a project that they had. So the research that we have been doing is simply giving feedback. And not only have we given feedback to Georgia Tech, we have also done two others. There's been a nutritional app that has requested our feedback, and a survey monkey regarding a flu study and the informational aspect and the understandability of that study. So along with these meetings and events, we also participate at professional meetings like this one. We have participated at Emory, Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, and Georgia Tech. And here is an example of pictures from Emory, where we had a stand regarding our meeting, And we also had two of our members present some technology that they have developed and created themselves. So like Madison mentioned, we do have a lot of participation at these meetings, and this is just an example that really does highlight that. We have been to the AAP conference, PAS, and also the 2040 conference, and we attend ICANN summits such as the one in Washington, D.C., and then the one we'll be going to in Barcelona. So thank you. Our next speaker comes up. I'm going to show a quick video, but his name is Matthew Clark, and he is a ninth grader, and he will be going in as the treasurer for next year.
What is the yellow?
We don't understand.
Therapies and medications and loving parents and so on and so forth, I've been able to really, you know, explore the world. So with a little biography first, So, it's there. So I was born in Western Colorado to a pair of parents who've loved me ever since. And from a very early age, as you can see, I loved to read. Reading was just sort of a natural reflex for me. It allowed me to stimulate myself in ways that nothing else could. But things couldn't be too stimulating, though. Otherwise, I'd get very stressed out. I think my ossicles cracked a lot when I was a kid, but thankfully I can still hear. In fact, it was this tendency to get overstimulated that led to my diagnosis with autism. Anyone here ever work for Mary Washington Hospital? Any hands? Wow, none. Y'all, guys, y'all missed out on the chance to diagnose my April 24th, 2003 was the exact date. So that was where the journey began, and I learned how to master myself really through floor time with the DIR model. My parents began attending a lot of conferences, and they learned that that was particularly effective, so they started doing that in Virginia. We moved back here to Atlanta, and that's where the work really began to get intense. I had a developmental psychologist, occupational therapist, and speech therapist all working on me. I was subjected to a battery of therapies. Among these was Simonis and Tomatis. I can't really remember what the names are. But it involved pumping classical music into my ears at very, very high volumes in order to stimulate certain nervous responses, such as, for example, pain. At about the same time, I learned about autism assistance dogs. And it was a long and arduous process, but I finally got myself one. Its name was Ajax, and it was an amazing dog. He'd always restrain me if I ever got hyper and wanted to run and all that. And also, he helped me he was sort of a cushion that I could lie down against if I got ever really tense or really tired or so on and so forth. At any rate, I discovered when I went to a legitimate school that gymnastics and hypnotherapy were particularly helpful, and so I began taking that on as a challenge. The effects of the service dog were enormously compounded by what I had done at Lionheart. Lionheart was the school that allowed me to first explore the social world. If not for that school, I wouldn't have a chance to go to college like I want to, get a career like I want to. I wouldn't even be standing up here presenting this talk if it weren't for the wonderful people who see those pictures. At first, I was very used to the sort of lenient aspects of being homeschooled. So a legitimate school's rules sort of put a lot of pressure on me, but eventually I reaped a ton of sociological benefit and was able to actually proceed to another school known as Mill Springs Academy. I went there for 1 year and came out the other side at Wesleyan, where I still am today. But of course, the most important part about Wesleyan is the fact that my entire family just centers around it. It is the nucleus of my family. It is the nucleus of my entire life. All the people that you see in these pictures have just been so influential. Great therapists, they've never given up on me. They always, always, always work for free. They... yes, that was funny. They just love me and always are trying to teach me how to get out of my head and explore deeper relational possibilities. What you see here are a few of the battery of activities that I do with Wesley. And one of my favorite things about Wesleyan is, of course, the academic activities that I was going to do. I made it to the final four of my IQ team, who are pictured in that selfie and then the picture next to it. And then I also placed ninth in the state twice in the National Geography Bee, and I qualified for the state spelling bee 4 years in a row, placing third most recently. In fact, I'd now like to present to you how my brain works. I want one of you, any of you, to name the most obscure country you can think of, and I will attempt to name his capital. Any hands? Anyone? Yes.
Malaysia.
I believe that would be Yangon or sorry, I was speaking ahead of myself. Kuala Lumpur. Speaking ahead of myself, I was getting confused with Myanmar. And now, I'd like for you to, so now I would like for one of you to also try and think of the most difficult word you can think of, and I'll try to spell it. Yes. Cockadoodle. Ouagadougou, the capital of Burkina Faso, yes. O-U-A-D-O-U-G-O-U. C. There is a scientific explanation for all of this. See, when he said Malaysia, I was instantly visualizing maps that I'd seen in my head of the sort of Indochina region that Malaysia is part of. And I instantly visualized, oh yes, Kuala Lumpur, that's the capital, now located in the southern end. As for the spelling, well, I just studied a lot of African and French words, and I also looked at a lot of geography stuff, so I just happen to know how Ouagadougou is spelled. Thank you all, and up next we have Hampton Woods, who is one of my good friends through ICANN, and this year he will be serving as the technology officer. Please, everybody, welcome Hampton Woods.
My name is Hampton Woods. I'm 15 years old and a freshman in high school. I'm an honor student with a 4.2 GPA. I'm involved in robotics, marching, and concert band. I recently launched a biomedical device startup, and I'm also one of the technology officers for Kids Georgia, along with my friend Jake. When I was 4 months old, I was diagnosed with idiopathic cirrhosis with level 4 scarring. Without a liver transplant, I would die within a year. Because I was so healthy in every other way, and because donated organs for infants are scarce, the chances of getting a cadaveric organ were small. I was placed on the organ donation list, but my family and doctors knew we had to find another way. I had an unrelated living donor liver transplant when I was 11 months old. My donor, Heidi Biggie, is my aunt and married to my mom's brother. And that began my journey of living with someone else's liver. Because my body sees my aunt's liver as foreign, I was placed on 3 immunosuppressive drugs, Celsef, a steroid, and Prograf. Just the right amount of the drugs had to be in my system. Too much, and it becomes toxic to my body. Too little, and my body's immune system rejects my liver. As an infant, I received these medications through a G-tube, custom compounded by a pharmacist recommended by our transplant department. He was a comfort to my frightened parents, and was always there to answer questions. My dad traveled with his job during this time, and knowing my medication would be delivered straight to our doorstep made my mom breathe easier. Pharmacist, know your compassion and knowledge matters a lot to family members. I'm fine. Of course, I don't remember that time. My parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, and family friends all have told me about it. Because of the immunosuppressant medications have side effects, like increased risk for certain cancers and high blood sugar, and because people who take these drugs can get live vaccines, and if we get sick, it's a very big deal, my parents didn't tell me much. They didn't want me to be scared or not want to live life. I only knew that I had to take my medicine every 12 hours exactly, that I couldn't have ibuprofen or have grapefruit. The medication tasted good. I was like, okay, medication could taste stuff again. I do remember something about taking my medicine early in life that were different or were inconvenient. We carried a cooler around everywhere we went because some kind of program needs to be refrigerated. Alarms around my house were set to program time. Everything I touched was sanitized. Rubbing, scrubbing, sterilizing, and disinfecting were a part of my childhood. That was just normal for me. I was a tad bit paranoid when it came to my restrictions because of my medication, which was both a good thing and a bad thing. My parents did not give me much information. They knew I had to take the meds to keep me going, so there wasn't much need to give me scary statistics. That viewpoint changed one day when I was 5 years old. While visiting my grandmother and baking in her kitchen, she told me to wash my hands after cracking an egg. I noticed the soap in her kitchen had a picture of grapefruit on it and became very upset. This, as you all know, is just because it increases the efficacy of the medication. Somehow, in my 5-year-old mind, I thought it could cause a horrible reaction to kill me. After hearing this from my grandmother, my parents knew it was time to give me more information about both my transplant and my medication. It did make me feel better. I accepted it, knowing that this is who I am. Nothing can change it. I was able to swallow pills right around this time, so we were able to get my prescription from the pharmacy inside our local grocery store. Mostly, I had a very normal childhood. We took family trips to the beach and to Disney World. I played baseball, soccer, and basketball. I went to school and church, even though my family was concerned about what I might catch there. I even competed in 3 iCan-KIDS triathlons. Things pretty much went along normally until 4th grade. We don't really know why things changed my body, but I spent 30% of my 4th grade year too sick to attend school because of illnesses related to my immunosuppressant medication. My parents decided to move me to a smaller school, and that made all the difference. I really loved running my school's cross-country team. However, in 6th grade, I began to have leg pain when I ran more than a mile or so. Thinking it was just muscle pain and growing pains, I just ran straight through it. One day, all of a sudden, the pain became unbearable, and my parents took me to the emergency room. It turned out to be myositis, an infection deep within my muscle. We don't really know for sure, but it's likely that I was more susceptible to having this infection because of my meds. That was the last straw. I was angry. I had already been approached about pain part in a research study to withdraw from my medication. My parents were a little concerned about my participation because I'd been doing so well. I was thinking about it, but the leg infection made the decision for me. I knew this was my opportunity to help myself while also having the opportunity to direct the lives of future transplant recipients. When the study began, I was asked to sign an assent, a document that outlined what was expected of me. What would happen to me. I knew I had a choice and the voice more in what would happen to me. I attended the Pediatric Academic Society Conference in San Diego in 2015, along with other ICANN members, to present a poster on the importance of pediatric assent in clinical trials. Next studies. I have been in a study called Abbott since I was 12 and successfully withdrew from my medication course of a year and remained off my medication for a full year. I agreed to biopsies and frequent blood draws. It was worth it. I was free. I went away to summer camp and swam in a somewhat dirty lake. I walked around losing grass barefoot, no longer worried that I may step on something that could cause a life-threatening infection. My parents were being felt a less burden adulthood for me. Unfortunately, after last year's biopsy, small change in my liver tissue was detected. This meant I had to go back on my medication. The good thing is, I'm on such a small dose, about a fourth of my previous dose, so I'm not really negatively impacted. I have an alarm on my phone, my mom, dad, and little sister, and I can be about taking it. I'm still very close to the monitor, and will be the rest of the long, exciting life I plan to lead. Through raising awareness at events such as this, and through outreach in our local ICANN chapters, we We have to make the lives of chronically ill and medically fragile children better by giving them a voice. I know that when my doctors and parents see a disabled child next to me, I feel like I'm in control of my condition, and my condition is in control of me. Thank you for letting me speak today.
First, I got on boys. Over a year, my liver, I got my first liver transplant. But it failed, so I got another one. Katie goes home. And in this bag here, it has 15 medicines in it when I had to go home, and it was a lot to take. At least, so let's not keep it inside the bag. These are not all of them. This is a few. So how do I take all of this? How do I take all of that medicine? Nasal do. The pick and line. And through my mouth. Did it get better? I got down to one. For a graph. My doctor asked if I wanted to be on the trial. What's that? How does it help? No more medicine, help other children, and help doctors make better decisions. I only got to help for a little while. Every week I got labs. One week my labs were not happy. My liver went into rejection. What's happening now with Haley? Every morning I take 6 emails, Prograf and Prozac. Every night, I take 6 inhales, Prozac and Zantac. Every 4 weeks, I go back to labs. How does this all work in school? School is very hard for me. Why? Sometimes my head is nauseated and it's very fuzzy for me to concentrate. Super tired, not there, and sick. Makeup work, tutoring, IED plan, and all that. The IED plan stands for children that need help through testing and schoolwork. And homebound means that when you're out of database, then the teacher, a third person, comes to your home and helps you with your schoolwork. So now, you know about my body, but who is Katie Polk? I do swimming. I hang out with my friends all the time. I play basketball. I'm a Christian. And I love music. And I'm a really good fashion designer. And I love playing soccer. And I'm part of the Kids Georgia. this is what I think about it. A lot of people think it's a mystery how children go through this, and it's really hard for certain people. So when I go to school, I feel frustrated, and I think my IEP plan is not working, but it actually is. And people think that, oh, you're sick because you don't want to go to school, or you're just faking it. It's not really like that. So I try to keep it to myself all the time, but it's really hard. I was born with neurodegeneration, and I have insomnia, which makes me stay up at night. That's why I'm not allowed to have any naps during the day. And it's really hard for me to go like this and take meds every day of my life. Thank you.
Again, you can visit our website or visit our booths or email the address in our seat.